This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We are certainly glad that each and every day God gives us a new day at life, gives us new opportunities to see Him, to experience Him, and to share the love that He so graciously shares with us each and every day. And so we gather as His children from this beautiful sanctuary space as we gather in person and from our homes. We gather here at St. Paul's United Church of Christ, 104 Green Street in Sellersville, Pennsylvania. I am Pastor Trudy, and I am delighted to be here with each and every one of you in this time of worship. Our September newsletter is in circulation in various ways. If you are not receiving the newsletter in the way you would like to receive it, please let us know. The newsletter goes out if you have an email address via email. There are some folks that request the newsletter be mailed to them, a hard copy, through the Postal Service. And then there are some church mailboxes where folks prefer to receive their newsletter in the church mailbox. As we enter into this soon coming season of fall, this is the time that we relook at everything. Looking at our email addresses, our mailing addresses, looking at those that now prefer online giving and may not want an offering envelope. I throw that all out there in your corner this morning, letting you know that whether, again, you're gathering virtually or gathering in person, now's the time to share updates with us so we can get our lists updated as we move forward. Next Sunday, Welcome Sunday, 9 a.m. service will be in the Fellowship Hall. We are going to change things up a bit this year. Nancy, our Christian Ed Director, and myself will be leading that time of service. It'll be a time of worship, and it'll also be a time of Sunday school revival. So I am looking forward, as Nancy is, to gathering with all of you next Sunday. We are delighted that Paul Kohler and his kitchen crew will be preparing a pancake breakfast for our enjoyment that will come after that time of worship and revival. And we invite all of you to stay for that time of celebration and looking forward again into the new fall season. As we transition to our 10:15 a.m. worship time on September 18th, we will continue with support from Growth and Hospitality, having our cookies, coffee, and conversation. I don't have the clipboard available this morning. I think Robin has some things available that she's going to tell us about in a few minutes. But the clipboard to sign up for the CCC will be available next Sunday in the Fellowship Hall. So please look for that and be prepared to sign up so we can have that time of fellowship as we continue on again into the season of fall. Robin, before I forget, do you want to come up and share with us some information about the crop walk that's coming in October?
Good morning. The crop walk is about a month away, October 9th. What the committee had done when we met, they did a count your blessing calendar, which starts next week. So what I did is I have them back in the narthex, clipped together, and with a Ziploc bag. And it's a fun thing to do, not just for kids, for anybody. Like the first day is count your faucets and 10 cents for every faucet you have. That way it gives us a little extra money. And like Pastor Trudy said, with the drought going on, anything helps with the crop walk. You'll hear more about it, but I wanted to get the calendar out since it starts next week. You can start at any time you want. But back in the narthex, they're all stapled together, and please take one if you like. And like I said, the crop walk is October 9th, so please think about walking, supporting it. Thank you.
Thank you, Robin. We are starting work already on the October newsletter. There is a lot of activity, a lot of events, a lot of special things for us to share in together, to gather together, and support events such as the crop walk. I'm thankful to Robin doing so much behind the scenes. There is always that piece of it. A lot of times we will see a finished product like her handout, but there were meetings that had to be attended, there were communications, things that she had to pass on to the church secretary to get done in order for that to be here and available for you. And so again, Robin, thank you. World Communion Sunday is October 2nd, and then we would have the crop walk the following Sunday on October 9th. Just lifting up and being mindful in our community of faith that we are called to pray for one another, whether it's someone within the congregation that we personally know, or that it's just lives around the world being affected in various ways, that we pray for folks. We know that wildfires continue in the western part of our country. Flooding has been ongoing concerns for communities as we look now at a map that shows Bucks County in a drought, a drought watch. And so for me, it brings back memories that I would rather forget. But years ago, in the early to mid 80s, Kevin and I experienced a severe problem with the water issue in our hometown. And it's not fun for someone like Kevin working in fiberglass 8 to 10 hours and then coming home and having no water for a shower. The drought is serious. And so we just continue to watch over one another. Since that experience, it might seem simple, but when I brush my teeth, the water is not kept running. The toothbrush is wet, the water gets turned off, and then to finish up brushing my teeth, it's turned back on again. I've been taking gallon jugs and just giving our plants now a little bit of water, and I've been doing that for weeks instead of having sprinklers running, because every little thing we do, folks, helps. It is conserving. It is taking care of God's creation. I am aware of the problems in Jackson, Mississippi, having a major water plant failure. That was about 6 days ago. They are working like 24/7 to restore that water supply. People are standing out in lines for hours in the heat to receive bottled water. Again, we count our blessings, but we are mindful. As we gather this morning in the beauty of this place, that there are challenges facing our brothers and sisters in God, in our country, in our community, and around God's world. And so we hold each and every one on our hearts as we continue in this time of worship as God's children, as brothers and sisters in Christ. We're also mindful that it is a holiday weekend. We'll hear more about that later in my reflection, but praying for traveling mercies as folks have opportunities to maybe take advantage of some last days at the beach or just simply family gatherings for picnics and traveling many miles. We pray for safety for all. As we continue in our time of worship, I invite those that are gathered in person and those that are able to please stand and share with me in the responsive call to worship. The church is made up of all kinds of people, short and tall, young and old and in between, skin of every tone on earth, and colorful languages to match.
There we celebrate.
All are welcome by the Spirit of Christ when we doubt and when we hold firm to beliefs, when we feel like being outgoing extroverts or quiet contemplatives. The rainbow expressions of faith are all gathered in.
There we celebrate.
Each one of us has an important part to play, a story to tell, a voice for singing, an insight to share, a talent to offer.
Together we celebrate.
And we join our voices together as we lift them in song and sing our opening hymn, Brethren, we have met to worship. May we be attentive to your holding now and bask in your affirmation in this moment of silence. Loving God, we will praise you, for truly we are wonderfully made. In Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen. The gathered congregation may be seated. Like young birds taking flight from their maternal rest, God desires our freedom. Yet we often restrict ourselves and others, diminishing life in so many ways. Together, let us approach God's heavenly throne of grace and offer our responsive prayer of confession. Let us pray. Loving God, in the church, we fence in our faith experiences with rigid rules, doctrines, and ideas of what is acceptable. As individuals, we bind ourselves to shoulds, woulds, and oughts imposed on us by external voices, often from ages past. We also enslave one another by using others for our gain and silencing voices of dissent. Amen. And with joy come these words of affirmation that again we share together responsively With liberated hearts, we affirm once again.
Our freedom is your desire. You freely and liberally and love generously in order to free our hearts. May we do likewise for ourselves and others.
Praise be to God. Amen. Thank you, Neil, for turning off the fans that were definitely becoming quite overpowering. As I prepare for worship, I am mindful, and I'm sure you are too, on how much I miss the children's chats. And I am so delighted that next Sunday's service will include that children's chat, and that our return to 10:15 a.m. worship on September 18th will include a children's chat from there forward. Before entering into the scripture passage that has been selected for this morning's time of worship, I invite you to join me as we open our hearts and our minds and our ears to our God. Join me in this prayer of illumination. O God, open our minds and hearts as we listen to your holy word. May we discover today how our community can live your way. Amen. Thousands of years ago, so long ago that no one living today can remember, a man named Paul went from city to city telling people about Jesus. Some people were upset when Paul said that Jesus was the child of God. Paul and the people who went with him began churches in the cities where they preached and taught. Other people were upset that Paul included people who weren't Jewish in these churches. All in all, Paul always seemed to have someone angry with him. But Paul had many good friends who helped him and protected him. Still, Paul was put in jail more than once. When the story we hear today takes place, Paul was in prison and could not travel to visit the churches he helped begin. Instead, unheard of today, Paul wrote letters to them. He reminded the people how much God loved them. He praised them for following God's way. Sometimes he scolded them for forgetting what he had taught them. The letter for today's story is different from the other letters. Paul is writing to a man named Philemon, who is his friend. Paul wants Philemon to do something special. Listen for the word of God as we listen to Paul and what he wrote to Philemon. I, Paul, and a prisoner for the sake of Christ, here with my brother Timothy. I write this letter to you, Philemon, my good friend and companion in this work, also to our sister Apphia, to Archippus, a real trooper, and to the church that meets in your house. God's best to you. Christ's blessings on you. Every time your name comes up in my prayers, I say, oh, thank you, God. I keep hearing of the love and faith you have for the Master Jesus, which brims over to other believers. And I keep praying that this faith would hold in common, that we hold in common, keeps showing up in the good things we do, and that people recognize Christ in all of it. Friend, you have no idea how good your love makes me feel. Doubly so when I see your hospitality to fellow believers. In line with all this, I have a favor to ask of you. As Christ's ambassador and now a prisoner for him, I wouldn't hesitate to command this if I thought it necessary, but I'd rather make it a personal request. While here in jail, I've fathered a child, so to speak, and here he is, hand carrying this letter. Onesimus. He was useless to you before. Now he's useful to both of us. I'm sending him back to you, but it feels like I'm cutting off my right arm in doing so. I wanted in the worst way to keep him here as your stand-in to help out while I'm in jail for the message. But I didn't want to do anything behind your back. Make you do a good deed that you hadn't willingly agreed to. Maybe it's all for the best that you lost him for a while. You're getting him back now for good, and no mere slave at this time, but a true Christian brother. That's what he was to me. He'll be even more than that to you. So if you still consider me a comrade in arms, welcome him back as you would me. If he damaged anything or owes you anything, chalk it up to my account. This is my personal signature, Paul, and I stand behind it. I don't need to remind you, do I, that you owe your very life to me? Do me this big favor, friend. You'll be doing it for Christ, but it will also do my heart good. I know you well enough to know you will. You'll probably go far beyond what I've written. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God. So here we are, Labor Day weekend upon us already. Where has the summer gone? And yet the calendar reminds us that there are still a few weeks left to the summer. But yet this is a weekend that is embraced, as I shared as we gathered together for maybe that last trip to the beach. Maybe a weekend of camping with friends and family. But like Memorial Day weekend, sometimes I think it's good for us to be reminded of the why of the holiday. On Memorial Day weekend, I like to be reminded that it's not just about laughter and get-togethers and picnics, but it is to remember those brave men and women that gave their lives in defense of the freedoms of our country. And so, in this moment, in this time, and in this place, we're going to pause to reflect spiritually on the deeper meaning of this national holiday, Labor Day, and we will find that it isn't, again, just about last-minute trips to the beach, about last-minute camping trips, and folks, it's not about retail and Labor Day sales. There is deeper meaning and deeper significance. We have to begin with a bit of an American history lesson. The celebration of Labor Day, a day of rest and respect, came out of conflict. First celebrated in 1882 in the 19th century by the Central Labor Union in Boston, Labor Day became a federal holiday in 1894. In response to the deaths of a number of workers during the Pullman strike between labor unions and railroads. Sadly, very sadly, the government was set against the people as U.S. Marshals and military forces were responsible for the deaths of striking workers. It was in response to this abuse of power that President Grover Cleveland made reconciliations with the labor movement a top national priority. Although the church was often at the sidelines, and even in some cases were against workers' rights, there was a term and a movement that grew, and it was called the social gospel. Years ago, we might have turned to the hard copy of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Now today, we simply Google. And what we find about the social gospel is this. Advocates of the movement interpreted the kingdom of God as requiring social as well as individual salvation, and sought the betterment of industrialized society through application of the biblical principles of charity and justice. The movement goes on to be described as recognizing where the intersection of faith and common beliefs meet. And it played a major role in securing justice for working people. The encyclopedia goes on to describe it as labor reforms, including the abolition of child labor, amen, a shorter work week, a living wage, and factory regulation. That is what constituted the social gospel's most prominent concerns. The labor movement, often in partnership with Christian leaders, went on to become the source of many of the benefits and the rights that both blue-collar and white-collar employees still hold dear today. You are familiar with them. Vacations, holidays, workers' compensation, days off, health insurance, disability, and those group negotiations called collective bargaining. I'm not trying to steer you in one direction or another in what you believe about that social gospel, but I can share with you that it was a part of my life as my father worked for over 35 years for Alcoa, the Aluminum Company of America, and was served and protected by a workers' union. You might be surprised that as we dig into this reading from Paul's letter to Philemon, that it is really an appropriate read for this Labor Day weekend. The short book of Philemon is an incredible letter, folks. You heard the letter. You heard what he wrote to Philemon. He is persuasive. He's even clever in his letter. But Paul also recognizes this intersection where faith and common beliefs meet as he reaches out to Philemon to secure justice. He wants fairness. He wants things to be right for Onesimus. During the second half of the first century, very sadly, slavery was considered an institution of single importance to the Roman imperial regime. So sad we didn't learn that lesson well. The letter is addressed to Philemon, the owner of Onesimus, the slave. There are many interpretations, a lot of commentaries that one sorts through to bring us to this place. All details are never shared in scripture passages, folks, and all details were surely not shared in this letter. What is considered is that very possibly, Onesimus has left, possibly run away from his owner, Philemon, and Paul is sending him back. But Paul is arguing very forcefully that going forward, Philemon should not regard Onesimus as a slave, but as more than a slave, a true brother in Christ. And Paul is putting out every stop that he can think of to convince him. We read in the letter that it is promised that if there are any debts that Onesimus owes Philemon, anything that may have accumulated, he says, if he damaged anything or owes you anything, chalk it up to my account. Don't hold it against him. And Paul, again being clever, reminds Philemon of all that he owes to Paul. Now, Philemon, I don't need to remind you, do I, that you owe your very life to me. If we were listening very carefully, even as Paul began this letter, he is encouraging Philemon, affirming their walk of faith that they have shared in Christ. Philemon, I keep hearing of the love and faith you have for the Master Jesus, which brings over to other believers. And I keep praying that this faith we hold in common keeps showing up in the good things we do, and that people recognize Christ in all of it. Friend, you have no idea how good your love makes me feel, doubly so, when I see your hospitality to fellow believers. Essentially, family of God, what Paul is doing is he's calling on Philemon to live out that new life, that new identity of being a child of God, a brother and sister in Christ, a believer in Jesus Christ, to live that new life out in a new way, and to move beyond the common, legal, accepted practice of the Roman imperial regime. Paul urges Philemon to follow the law of Christ's love, to follow Christ's justice, rather than the regulations of Roman slave law. Just like Philemon, each of us today is involved in our culture's values and common practices. Many of these values and practices are in harmony with our faith, but others are not. Do we recognize? Will we admit that there are pieces of our lives, things we do and think, that with deeper reflection we would see as conflicting? That we would see as not in agreement with our call and our identity as followers of Christ? Behind the identity given to us by society lies our true identity in relationship with God and with Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Living as Christ's own empowers us to build relationships of love. It empowers us to build relationships of respect with one another. Do we ever pause for a moment on a daily basis and consider our identity that we have in Christ? Do we consider on a daily basis our relationship with Christ? A relationship that we say here at St. Paul's, that's where we want to grow. We want to grow in our relationships with Jesus Christ and with one another. Are we doing that? Are we talking about it? Are we sharing the joy of that relationship and how it brings us closer and how we can humble ourselves more with one another when we lay some of that brokenness bare to one another and we share wherever we're at? That maybe not being prideful, but that we can share in the joy of the accomplishments of our children. They have amazing opportunities before them, and in our relationship with Christ, it is our joy to share that relationship with others and let them know the goodness that is growing. On this Labor Sunday, folks, it's good for us, even if just for a brief moment, to examine our lives, to pay attention, and recognize that intersection of faith and common beliefs. I like to say it's where the sacred meets the secular. They both need to live together as we reach out to secure justice and fairness for all. How can we be like Paul? Where is the best place and what is the best way to get involved to make things in this world better? I know that we cannot do everything, but we can do something. God's abundance, not scarcity, has been poured on us to be shared among all God's people. And yet, as we meet, as we shared, as we began our time of worship, recognizing situations with wildfires and droughts and lack of water, we know that everyone is not living the abundant life, though it is still God's vision for each of us. Let us search our hearts, examine our actions, and seek the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Again, I know that we cannot help all of our neighbors. I think we're on the right track here at St. Paul's. I know I still have a colleague that would love for us to be involved in disaster relief as we try to figure out how we all live together with Rampacks and Fostering Hope and Recharge and Sunday school coming back and worship services and numbers declining, and yet God calls us and shares with us his abundance and reminds us, no, maybe we can't help all of our neighbors, but we can help some of them. To God and God alone, folks, be all the glory this day and every day. Amen. Let us join our voices together as we sing loudly and boldly, in the cross of Christ, I glory.
Thank you.
we lift up and hold on our hearts those that we are aware of are crying out to God today that are feeling more scarcity and abundance. We go as a community to God in prayer with these spoken words that I offer, but also recognizing that God takes those silent prayers and those names from your hearts. May we also lift up and share with God the joys, the waiting for a new baby to arrive, relationships coming together in new marriages, new school opportunities, folks settling into maybe some changes, maybe a little frightening, but knowing again, as we shared with the children last week, that God is with them, that God is with us. Let us pray. The sun rises, the darkness fades, and a new day unfolds with possibilities before us. When we allow grace to have its way, we see beauty shining everywhere and our hearts grow warm with gratitude. By your Spirit, we become people of grace. We become people of peace, who enlarge the presence of beauty in the world. Though the laws of our land abolished slavery and all have the right to know the goodness of this world, some still await liberation. Some still await freedom. We pray for asylum seekers and refugees. We pray for political prisoners and those who speak out for justice. We pray for those who endure deplorable working conditions and those who make their home in poverty and civil unrest. Loving God, by your Spirit, may we be people of grace. May we be people of peace. We know, O God, that some are silenced or excluded from the tables of influence and leadership because of the color of their skin, because of their gender, their socioeconomic reality, or their differing perspectives. But you welcomed all people, erasing the labels of distinction. Again, O God, we ask, by your Spirit, may we be people of grace. May we be people of peace. Humbly, God, we know that some are imprisoned by the suffering of their mind, the suffering of their bodies and souls. From such a place, it can be hard to imagine the way forward, to hold on, to hope that healing will come. Loving God, by your Spirit, may we be people of grace. May we be people of peace. Even as we delight in the beauty of life, may we see clearly the situations that are in need of our compassionate involvement, so that in and with and through your Spirit, we may be people of grace and peace in this world. Amen. After going to God in prayer, we come to actually one of my favorite times of worship, where we can recognize the generosity, the giving, never-ending love of our God. And so today we are reminded that there is a difference between planning and preparation. We cannot plan the future that God holds. But we can prepare for each day by practices of generosity. Generosity helps us to forgive. Generosity helps us to heal. It helps us to make peace in the world. It helps to bring justice and mercy to those in need. And our gifts this morning, well, they are one way that we prepare for God's coming into the world in the most unexpected ways.
Thank you.
to God our prayer of dedication, followed by the prayer that he taught us to pray, the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. All that we are is gathered into the heart of Christ. Nothing and no one is excluded. Through this unconditional love, the brilliance of Christ's community shines out. We are loved. We are welcomed. We will be Christ together, extending welcoming love to the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we continue to pray in one voice, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before the sending forth and singing our closing hymn, I remind you that there is a time of refreshments, lemonade on the lawn, I believe, in Fred's Hall, prepared for you. It was wonderful, folks. I don't always get to greet all of you after worship, and I sure can't greet any of you worshiping from home, but it is an absolute delight, again, to be here together and be worshiping our God and giving him all honor and all glory and all praise. Occasions to offer grace and peace are all around us. Every day presents opportunities to express forgiveness, acceptance, and hospitality, if we have eyes to see and ears to hear. For the spirit of reconciliation is within us, stirring, urging, moving us toward one another and deeper into the soul of God. May we depart in the peace of Christ. May we depart in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so we join our voices together in song one more time as we sing joyfully, I hope, living for Jesus.